So friends, today we are discussing moment of inertia and rotational motion. What is second moment of mass? Second moment of mass is moment of inertia. Moment of inertia we always calculate about some axis. In rotational motion, this would be the axis of rotation. If we have a mass m1 and its perpendicular distance from the axis about which we are calculating the moment of inertia is r1, and likewise we have number of masses and their perpendicular distances from the axis are known to us, then we write moment of inertia I equal to m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square and so on. So the point to be noted is that moment of inertia is always calculated about some axis. In rotational motion problems, that should be the axis of rotation, and r1 r2 these distances are the distance of the mass from the axis, and whenever it is a distance between a point and a line, so it is the perpendicular distance. So we calculate like this. So this summation we can also write like this for a continuous body. If we have a body like this, I have to find out the moment of inertia of this body about this axis, then this is my small mass dm, its perpendicular distance is r, and r square into dm. If I integrate this, I'll get the moment of inertia for the entire body. So we also call it as second moment of mass. For example, when we take the moment of a force, so which we call as torque, so what is that? Force into perpendicular distance. So moment of mass will be mass into perpendicular distance, and second moment of mass means take the moment once again, so mr into r. So that's the reason we call it as second moment of mass. So it means if mass is more, moment of inertia will be more. If for a given mass the distance from the axis is more, moment of inertia will be more. Now we have some theorems that how do we calculate the moment of inertia about some axis if the moment of inertia is given about some other axis. So what are those theorems? Theorem of parallel axis. So what is theorem of parallel axis? If I have the center of mass of this body here, and I have to find out the moment of inertia of this body about some other axis which is parallel to this axis passing through center of mass, and let's say ICM is the moment of inertia of the body about an axis passing through center of mass, and I is the moment of inertia of this body about this axis which is parallel to this axis, and perpendicular distance between them is r, then theorem of perpendicular axis says that I equal to ICM plus mr square. M is the total mass of this body. So what is important to be noted here is that this theorem cannot be applied between any two parallel axes. It is applied between two axes out of which one is passing through center of mass, and other point to be noted is that this is ICM plus mr square, and then you get the moment of inertia about the other axis which is not passing through center of mass. For example, the formulas for the moment of inertia we know, like for a rod, thin rod, what is the moment of inertia about this axis passing through center of mass? If the length of the rod is L, so this ICM is ML square by 12. Now, if I have to find out the moment of inertia about this axis passing through one end and this is parallel to this axis, then this moment of inertia I is this ICM plus this distance is L by 2. So, ICM plus MR is L by 2 and this will become ML square by 12 plus ML square by 4. So this will become how much? This is ML square 1 by 12 plus 1 by 4. So this I can write 3 by 12. So this is 4 by 12 ML square by 3. Similarly, if we have a disk and this is an axis which is passing through the center of the disk, which is the center of mass of the disk and perpendicular to the plane of the disk. So this moment of inertia ICM is equal to ML MR square by 2. Where this is R. So moment of inertia of this disk is MR, half MR square, and if I have to find out the moment of inertia about this axis, which is parallel to this axis passing through the center of mass like this and parallel to this, so this moment of inertia I will be ICM plus MR square, and ICM is half MR square plus MR square equal to 3 by 2 MR square. Likewise, if we are having a ring, then in case of ring, if I have to find out the moment of inertia about this axis, every mass is at distance R. So this moment of inertia, this is center of mass, ICM equal to MR square. And if I have to find out about this axis, which is parallel to this, passing through center of mass, so this is ICM plus MR square. So this is 2 MR square. So I think we are clear that what is the moment of inertia, what is the theorem of parallel axis, and how to apply the theorem of parallel axis to find out the moment of inertia about some axis which is not passing through center of mass. It should also be noted that this theorem of parallel axis is applicable whether the body is linear like this rod, or it is two-dimensional body, plane like this ring or like this disc, or it is a three-dimensional body like a sphere. So if I have a sphere and it has moment of inertia, this is a solid sphere, its moment of inertia about the axis passing through center of mass is 2 by 5 MR square, all these formula you have to remember, then its moment of inertia about this axis which is tangent to the sphere, I can calculate by applying the theorem of parallel axis ICM plus MR square. And how, what is this ICM? 2 by 5 MR square plus MR square, so this is 7 by 5 MR square. So I think theorem of parallel axis is clear to us. If theorem of parallel axis is clear to us, then we will discuss about theorem of perpendicular axis. See, everybody knows the formula, but you know the important part is to understand its application and where is it applied. What is the important point to be noted? As I said, in this case, this theorem can be applied between two axes out of which one should pass through center of mass. So similarly, the theorem of perpendicular axis, I'm not writing the definition here because that's given in all the books. The important part is how to apply it and what exactly it is. The understanding is important, so I'm focusing on understanding part and how to apply it. So let's say this is a body. This is a plane body. Let's say I'm just assuming, I'll explain you why I'm saying plane body later on. And these are the three axes. This is a plane body in XY plane. So X axis and Y axis are in the plane of the body, like this plane of the board. And Z axis is like this, perpendicular to the plane of the board. Then theorem of perpendicular axis says that IZ, the moment of inertia about this Z axis, is equal to IX plus IY. This formula everybody knows, nothing special about it, but what are the things to be remembered when applying this equation? So first thing is that this theorem is applicable only for two-dimensional, that is planar bodies. Two-dimensional bodies, plane bodies like this blackboard. It's a plane body. It is not a three-dimensional body. Its thickness is much smaller as compared to its size, the length and the breadth. So this is a two-dimensional body, a plane body, like a plane sheet. Then these two axes about which the moment of inertia I am adding, these two axes shall lie in the plane of the body. You can name them anything, x, y is not important. Important is the moment of inertia of the two axes which you are adding should lie in the plane of the body. So x and y axes about which moment of inertia are, about which moment of inertias are added, shall lie in the plane of the body. The third important thing is that this axis about which, Z axis about which I am getting the moment of inertia by adding these two, is perpendicular to the plane of the body. So here Z axis is perpendicular to plane of body. Obviously all these three axes have a point of intersection. Now one more important point, that this point of intersection may coincide or may not coincide with the center of mass of the body. The theorem is applicable in both the cases. So even if center of mass of the body is somewhere here, that means this is not coinciding with the center of mass, the theorem is applicable. So theorem is applicable whether point of intersection of axes coincides with center of mass or not. So in both the cases this will be applicable. So what are the important points? That is important, definition is not important, the formula everybody knows. So what are the critical points to be remembered when you apply this equation is to be understood. For example, now if I consider that this is a ring, and you know the moment of inertia of this ring about this axis is how much? Mr square. And I have to find out the moment of inertia of this ring about any diameter. So this is a two-dimensional body. Any diameter will have the same moment of inertia because of the symmetry. Let's say this is x-axis, this is y-axis, and this is z-axis. So Iz here equal to Ix plus Iy. Iz is mr square, and Ix is moment of inertia about diameter. This is also about diameter. So about the diameter, how much is the moment of inertia of the ring? Half mr square. Likewise, in case of disk, if it is the disk, then Iz equal to, and the moment of inertia of the disk is how much? Half mr square, and this is I dia so what I get is the moment of inertia about the diameter is 1 by 4 mr square. Similarly, as we discussed, that if you have to apply now and find out about this axis, which is parallel to the diameter and tangent to this ring, then about this axis, about diameter is how much? Half mr square. So about this axis, let's say this is tangent. So how much is this I tangent? This is I dia, because this diameter, this is passing through center of mass. So I can apply between these two axes, plus m into r square. So plus mr square, and I dia is I think this is clear now, that what is the theorem of perpendicular axis, what are the things to be remembered when applying the theorem of perpendicular axis, and how do we apply it. I think if this is understood by everybody, then we move on, and I just explain you that what are the different moment of inertias for different bodies. Just to remember for your exam, in case of ring, we have already discussed that about this axis, when we talk about, this is perpendicular to the plane of the ring and passing through its center. So this moment of inertia I is equal to m r square. R is the radius, m is its mass. So this is a ring. Now if you have a hollow cylinder, and if you cut it, make it slices, then you will get ring. Each slice is like a ring. So moment of inertia of a hollow cylinder about its geometrical axis, which becomes this axis of the ring, if you make the slices, each slice is like a ring, the formula is same. Similarly, disk and solid cylinder are same. If you have a disk, then its moment of inertia about this axis, which is passing through its center and perpendicular to its plane, is and this is equivalent to the moment of inertia of a solid cylinder about its geometrical axis. This is solid cylinder, this is hollow cylinder. Because when you make the slices of a solid cylinder, what do you get? Each slice is like a disc. So the formula is same. Similarly, when you have a thin rod, so moment of inertia about this center of mass is ml square by 12. And we have calculated just now that if the axis is passing through its end, then moment of inertia is ml square by 3. So now we have the moment of inertia of a lamina. So if you have a sheet which is having a length L and breadth B, and you have to find out its moment of inertia about this axis which is perpendicular to its plane and passing through its center, then moment of inertia I is m L square plus B square by 12. You have to remember these formulas for your crash course for your JEE and NEET exams. So we are not going through the proof of this, but most of it, the basics of it, we have already discussed. You have to remember these formulas. Similarly, the solid sphere, when you have, so the moment of inertia, this is about an axis passing through its center of mass. This is 2 by 5 mr square. And when you have a hollow cylinder, hollow sphere, the moment of inertia is 2 by 3 mr square. Just a point to emphasize, whenever you get confused sometime, you know, that whether it is for solid cylinder or it is for hollow cylinder, you can easily understand that in hollow cylinder mass is at a larger distance because the center part of it is empty. So this moment of inertia of hollow cylinder will be higher. 2 by 3 is 0.67, this is 2 by 5 is 0.4. So this is of hollow, this is of solid, so you will never forget it. So this is the way to remember it, because that's also important. Now we talk about, you know, what type of questions are asked in your JEE exams related to the moment of inertia. So I'll take up the question which is asked in JEE 2000, January 2020. So question asked in JEE 2020 was that you have the three spheres just touching each other, each is having mass m, and the distance between them, between their centers, is d, and let's say this is A, this is B, this is C. This is the centroid of the triangle P. So you join this, you join this, and you join this. So this point is the centroid of the triangle P. The mass of each sphere is M. What has been asked is that what is the ratio of the moment of inertia of this system of three spheres about this point P upon about this point B. So what you, so this is an axis which is passing through P and perpendicular to this plane of the board. Similarly, an axis which is passing through B and perpendicular to this plane of the board, and you have to find out the ratio of IP, means about this axis and about this axis. So how to find out IP? So this is a question of JEE January 2020. So how to find out the moment of inertia about this? See, moment of inertia about this is moment of inertia about this, because this is passing through center of mass of this sphere, plus m into this distance square, mr square. This is what we learned in theorem of parallel axis. So moment of inertia of this solid sphere about this axis is what? We just learned 2 by 5 mr square, and plus when I have to apply theorem of parallel axis, so plus m into this distance square. So IP for this sphere is 2 by 5 mr square plus this distance m into AP square. And for all the three spheres it is same like this, so I make it three times. Now what is AP? That's the only problem remaining to find out. You see that you have this equilateral triangle A, B, C, and this is P. So this is given to you as D. So when this is given D and this angle, let's say this is M, or let's say this is Q. So this angle is 60, this is how much? 30 degree. So AQ equal to D cos 30. D cos 30 is D root 3 by 2. And AP is 2/3 of AQ. So this is D by root 3. So if it is D by root 3, so how much you are getting? 2 by 5 mr square plus m D by root 3 square into 3. So this is 3. And r is how much? The radius, which is D by 2. So okay, 3 into 2 by 5 m d by 2 square plus this is m d square by 3. So this is 2 by 5 m d square by 4 plus m d square by 3. So how much we are getting if we are multiplying this? So this is 3 md square, I can take common, so this is 3 by 10 plus 1, so this is 13 by 10 md square. Now similarly, when you have to calculate about this point B, this axis passing through point B and perpendicular to the plane of the board, so moment of inertia of this sphere about this point is 2 by 5 mr square. For this sphere it is 2 by 5 mr square plus this distance square, which is d m d square. For this also it is same 2 by 5, for this one 2 by 5 m d square mr square plus this distance m d square. So if I write now IB, the for this sphere it is 2 by 5 mr square, r is d by 2. Plus for this sphere it is 2 by 5 mr square plus this distance is d, so m d square, m d square. And for this sphere is also same, so multiplied by 2. So you can understand that how do we calculate these two values of the moment of inertia. Is that clear? So how much you get it? You can solve it. You get it 2/23/10 md square, and therefore IP is known to you 13/10, IB is known to you 23/10. So how much is IP by IB? IP is 13/10 md square, and this is 23/10 md square. So this 13/23 is my answer. So you can understand that if you know that what are the basic formulas of the moment of inertia, which I have already given you the list, then what is the theorem of parallel axis and perpendicular axis, and then how to apply that theorem, means what are the basics to be remembered when you are applying this equation, then the questions asked in JEE are not difficult. These questions become very, very easy to find out the value, whether it is asked the moment of inertia about some point or the ratio. So you can very easily calculate it. So we'll take up in the next lecture the next topic. I think moment of inertia, everybody has understood well.